story. Somebody's mother helped the school nurse, and there was some sort of special light to shine on our scalps, and I think tongue depressors to part sections of our hair. The mother was enthusiastic when she pointed, "Yes, there," as if a treasure had been found. That was not it. I knew, even before some of us were sent to a different room and given notes to take home. That was the way they did things back then in second grade. When they said ringworm, they said it with a shudder and a catch in the throat, as in you could catch it. So I stood behind the garage with my mother and her extra sharp 8-inch shears as she cut off my long hair and gave me bangs. I don't think she wanted to, but she did. I kept thinking about Bible school stories when God asked Abraham to kill his son, and he would have. And Isaac the innocent, Isaac the trusting, who even on the altar said, "Where is the lamb that is to be sacrificed?" Run, stupid, I thought. And though I knew I was no Samson, what about Mother Delilah? Yes, you could say I had a flair for the dramatic, but for sure, there was no acting in my tears as the strands fell around us, though I did try to act like a big girl, a brave girl, not a sissy. When I looked, the mirror said, "Hello, Buster Brown, Prince Valiant." The hat was the worst. It had to be worn everywhere. Others had store-bought, but that was extravagant. So Mother sewed mine out of a cotton print. You could say it was custom-made. If I'd known, I would have said it was my scarlet letter. And then, finally, we saw the dermatologist, who shook his head and said, "Dermatitis, a kind of cradle cap." But I was no baby. Even at 7, I already knew something about adults, about power and following orders, even about betrayal, though I couldn't have named it or said exactly what it was. The poet Stephen Dunn says, "Poetry is what you might find on the other side of certainty." So that a lot of what I write is a case of me arguing with me, trying to sort of look at both sides of the situation. And that's easy, relatively easy for me, because these days I'm pretty much uncertain about everything. Things I once thought I was certain of have sort of changed and altered a bit. The form of this poem is one that mirrors a poem of Stephen Dunn's titled The Imagined, but the content of my sacrifice. If the remembered faith makes the lack of faith seem lackluster, without imagination or grace or gorgeous excess, and if you come to realize the remembered faith can only satisfy the remembered self, whereas your current state, with all its limitations, can, if not console, at least make you feel you face down your truth, then how, in spite of knowing that, does the remembered faith keep getting into your head, joining your dinner conversation, accompanying you on vacations to cathedrals of stained glass and incense, to the oceans, surged and hallelujah? And if the lack of faith can only exist for you because of former faith, the two in lockstep, not a death grip, but hand in hand in every moment, whispering to each other endearments with the verve of lovers, or at least the checkmate of chess masters, would you feel better to know that the two exist for each other? Would it dry the tear that forms in the corner of the eye when the pipe organ swells? Or do you prefer to think the two discreet, as if mutuality did not exist? Isn't their tug of war, finally, the fugue of love, and your longing for him and amen necessary? Hasn't the time come, finally, to not pretend the stone warm when you lie down on the chosen altar?